Hi, everybody. This is State Senator Suzi Oppenheimer with a report from the New York State Senate. And as you know, each month I try and put on a program that I think is going to be of keen interest to the residents of Westchester. And today I think this is a very important topic for all Westchester residents. We're going to be talking about sustainability in our development, how we develop in a way that is not harmful to the environment, but then can be continued going forward, and we're all looking to try and promote, as much as we can, safe, sound, smart investments in our land. And we also are going to be talking about biofuels and how each one of us can benefit from this discussion, I think. Okay, so with me is Leah Cullen, the female to my right, and she's the sustainability coordinator for Westchester County Parks and Recreation. Big mouthful.
Thank you.
And closer to me is Tino Martin, and he's the superintendent of the Glen Island Park, where all of us have enjoyed ourselves over the years, I dare say. So let's start talking about the broader issue of sustainable development.
Well, one of the things that's wonderful about Westchester County is that we have a huge opportunity here. We have so many people of such diverse backgrounds, and we have so many people with great information about how to conserve and how to be cost efficient and how to reduce our carbon footprint. We have a chance for all these people to come together and talk about these ideas and to get the momentum behind them to implement them.
What group sits down and talks about this?
Well, we have there's hundreds of groups, and if you go online, you'll see thousands of groups internationally. In the county, there are groups that start with things like community gardens, and there are groups that work on energy efficiency. There are groups that work on with schools and businesses and homeowners. One of the educational groups we were talking about earlier is SELF. They're fantastic. They are the Children's Environmental Literacy Foundation, and they do great work with educating young people and giving them, empowering them to do more sustainable action within their school. And in the county, in the government of the county, we have all kinds of groups that are working together, green teams, and we have two green teams, one in the planning department and one in the parks department.
What's a green team? Let's enlarge on that.
Oh, the green team is a group of people who work for the department, and their submission is to try to figure out how to reduce our energy use and promote recycling, find better ways and more efficient ways of doing what we do, so we save taxpayer money, and we also promote conservation and reducing our fuel use overall, reducing our carbon footprint overall. Mm-hmm. Tino here is a part of our green team, and he's an amazing official of biofuels, of waste vegetable oil. And he's done some incredible work with that. We have other people who are working on ways to reuse things that are within our department. One of our team members actually composts. He's got the first office compost bin in any of our facilities. And we have groups that work on how to reduce energy. We have a gas reduction program we're working on right now that we're figuring out how to use less miles on our vehicles and how to reduce the trips that we go on in different places.
Isn't that just a case of time management? Or, you know, if we're going to two communities, we don't have to make two separate trips, but one
chain linking.
Yeah. Yeah, it is. It is a matter of time management. It's also a matter of looking at what size vehicle we're using. Like, we don't need to take an 8-cylinder truck 40 miles, and we could take a hybrid or a 4-cylinder vehicle. We look at what kind of load we're carrying from place to place. We have a messenger system. We revised that to reduce the number of miles we drive and the amount of fuel we use and the amount of time it takes for an employee to actually do that.
Mm-hmm. So, now, is this just in parks and recreation, or does this extend into other departments?
We're moving it outward. There's also a green team in the planning department, which was independent of our green team, And now we're having conversations about how to sort of seed these in different departments, and we're trying to figure out where that will go next.
I would figure it'd be essential to be with the planning department, because they're the ones that are looking forward rather than this is what exists now.
Absolutely. Tracy Corbett and the planning department have done an incredible job with their green team. They figured out how to recycle things that don't normally get recycled within our waste stream. They have the yogurt containers and bottle tops, and they have different sorts of issues in their department because they tend to be more office oriented. Our department tends to be, we have thousands of acres that we manage, and we have trucks and larger vehicles and garbage that we move for the public, and we have all sorts of different types of issues that we do. So our green teams have different kinds of focuses, but both are really essential.
Mm-hmm. I'm putting in a bill on the recycling of plastics. The insignia at the base of it is so tiny. Is that a one? Is that a two? Is that an A? Is that a B? I mean, so I've got a bill into, please make this larger. So I don't go racing around to find my eyeglasses just to read. But I know I'm recycling it, or I think I'm recycling it, or maybe I'm not recycling it. But a small thing, but it could be beneficial.
Yeah.
We're actually it starts with small things.
You're right.
And we're actually looking forward to how to recycle more in our parks this year because of the bigger, better bottle bill.
Yeah.
And we have now the non-carbonated beverage bottles that have a 5-cent deposit on them. So that's going to increase the ability to, or the incentive to recycle.
Well, the water bottles are the ones that are going to come in large demand. We actually didn't extend it as much as I wanted it to. I wanted to include juices, energy drinks, but it ended up the most we could get was water. But I think water is the main bottle that, you know, the main.
That's what we see in the parks
bottle.
More of. Is the
you know what
bottles.
I'd like to do? Yeah. I'd like to ban all water bottles.
Well, we've done that in our offices. We've gone
because
from,
we have such wonderful water here.
We've gone from the water coolers in the offices to a direct line and a filtration system, so we don't have to have the constant travel for the trucks delivering the water bottles. Also, that was
That's excellent.
Yeah, so we've reduced our consumption of water and water bottles to minimum.
That is excellent.
People don't realize it's not just the waste, it's the transportation that also creates a bigger problem sometimes than the waste itself.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the constant deliveries in and out.
Well, everyone in my office is aware, and I don't think we need to pick up a different plastic bottle every day. So we have a cooler in the outside part of our office up in Albany. And so I've got everyone trained to take their little plastic bottle and go back to the cooler. And then I think after a number of weeks or months, it kind of starts to look a little green at the bottom. I think that's the time to say, okay, I'm going to go get another bottle of a plastic bottle of water. But, you know, considering the value of our water, and also another feature is our water here in New York City has the fluoride in it, and that's very good for kids.
Mm-hmm.
And the bottled water doesn't have that.
No.
So the mothers may be finding themselves paying more for dental care.
That's true.
My commissioner, Joe Stout, is actually very forward-thinking and a great conservationist, and he's moved from plastic individual cups with tea in them to a glass pitcher with tea that he makes himself. He has like a solar tea that he makes, and he has stainless steel water bottle that he uses now when he carries it around from place to place.
Yeah, I mean, I have one like that, too, and I really think that's the answer. I mean, our water here is so remarkable. All you have to do is go, even just up to Albany, the water there, oh my God, the taste. I mean, I'm sure it's just as pure as this, but.
Yeah, a lot of it's well water and has a lot of sulfur and iron content to it.
Doesn't taste very nice.
And Westchester water is some of the best water in the world. And we're really promoting Westchester water. In a lot of the meetings that we have, will provide Westchester water, which is a pitcher with water in it and glasses instead of little plastic bottles of water that comes from somewhere.
Mm-hmm. And you should put on the outside of the pitcher, Westchester H2O.
Yeah. It's part of zero waste as well. Yeah, it is. It is. It's part of zero waste, too. I mean, the amount of material it takes to promote water, put water out, is minimal if you're putting a pitcher out. And there's incredible carbon footprint involved in moving cases of bottled water from place to place.
Talking about footprints and all, there's an issue that will be before us in Albany this year, and that's the issue of the Marsalis Shale up in the Catskills, the Adirondacks, and this Marsalis Ridge goes from our watershed, i.e. New York City watershed, which is our Westchester, and then it travels west, so it goes through the southern tier of New York, taking in Pennsylvania, going into Ohio, going into West Virginia. And now there is a move by some corporations to start drilling for natural gas in this Marsalis Shale area. And it takes thousands of gallons of water each day for innumerable wells to frack through, crush through the layers of shale. Not only does it have, I shouldn't be telling, you're starting to look very worried, and maybe you should. Sorry, Lynn.
Could be.
At any rate, this is in other states, and just millions of gallons of water are utilized every day to get through the shale.
Yeah, it also causes fracture in the shale, which drains other well water that people are using for their
own
home consumption, so it's a big issue.
And also,
it brings
we
in
didn't
contaminants.
Have this piece before, where it runs, once it gets down, then it runs horizontal.
Mm-hmm.
You have these long horizontal corridors. So it's millions of gallons of water which are going to be diverted from the normal runoff. And then after the water is used for fracking, that's what it's called, the shale, it's going to have all these chemicals in it.
Mm-hmm.
And so then what do you do with all this fouled water? I mean, they've talked about, just this week they were talking about putting this water that has all these contaminants in it into empty natural gas wells in the southern tier near Binghamton in that area. So, but it just is a potential catastrophe if it is in our New York City watershed, because our watershed gives water to, what, 9-10 million people. I'm not saying that it isn't bad for the smaller communities, too, but somehow I think I can remediate a community of 50 families. I don't know how you remediate, you know, our wonderful water that we get from up there. So that's going to be a huge issue this year because, I forget the name of the company, Chesapeake something company, is the main... They bought up most of these wells, and now they're subletting them to other entities. The problem is we might have a chance of stopping it, except that the families that live up there are very anxious to sell their land.
Mm-hmm.
They have been, subsistence farmers. They have absolutely, excess funds, much less do they have funds to meet their obligations. And they think this is a wonderful way, I'm going to get a lot of money from these gas companies.
Mm-hmm.
And so, we have a double problem. It's not just the companies, it's also the people whose land is being purchased at big bucks.
Mm-hmm. MountainKeeper.com is a good place to go for sources of information on that. They're monitoring all the
Say that again so everyone will hear.
Mountainkeeper.com is a Catskill newsletter that they send out, and they talk about a lot of the gas drilling that's going on in that area and the economic fallout from it.
Yeah, so, and also maybe the horror of losing our wonderful pure water. Mm-hmm. there's also River Keeper has been very involved. Mm-hmm. They're the people on the Hudson River. Mm-hmm. Sierra Club, Audubon, most of our environmental groups mm-hmm. are painfully aware of what this means. Mm-hmm. And so they're trying their best, you know, either to stop it or to get certain preventive measures put in, maybe encasing it in cement. You know, it is scary because...
There's no such thing as a free lunch. you solve one problem, you cause another.
So. You're right. Well, it's not just diverting the huge amount mm-hmm. of water. I think each one of the wells takes some million gallons of water, and there's going to be like hundreds of wells. Mm-hmm. So they're taking a lot of our water, and then they're leaving us with this polluted water. And what do we do with it? They say, oh, they'll truck it away. I mean, I don't know how you truck that quantity away. Mm-hmm. But that's something to be watched very closely in the next few months. We're going to have a hearing up in Albany in about 4 or 6 weeks, I think. So watch for that. The Senate Committee on Environmental Conservation, run by a Buffalo senator named Antoine Thompson. Mm-hmm. But so look for that, because we have to get lots of input. And try, if it's going to happen, which I pray not, but if it is, one possibility is to move the area that will be, have the wells, just over more west. So it would protect our New York City watershed. And as I said, I hate to think that I'm not trying to protect little farmer, but it's much easier to figure out an answer to that. than to where 10 million people drink. Okay, you're supposed to be talking, and all I'm doing is talking.
That's good.
Okay.
Fascinating.
We're learning new things every day.
Not that you don't know Tino. Okay, Tino, because we don't want to run out of time.
Yeah.
So, Tino, start on these bottles.
Start where you want to start. Okay. Well, actually, the bottles are good. This is what we call waste vegetable oil, and it comes from the county has over 60,000 gallons of waste vegetable oil is used in our concessions in our parks. So places from Playland and from Glen Island and from other locations that service our parks and our facilities, we generate a lot of waste, and the waste vegetable oil is carted away by vendors who provide dumpsters for the concessionaires in our parks to get rid of this material. Back in 2003, there was a what they called a grease fest. That was the first time that some individuals decided they were going to start utilizing some of our waste vegetable oils from our restaurants. And Jonathan Pratt from Peter Pratt's restaurant, he was one of the first individuals to actually take his vehicle, which was a pickup truck that he was paying about $800 a month to run on fuel, on diesel fuel, and he had a restaurant, so he said, let me see if I can convert my vehicle over to a system where I can use the waste vegetable oil from my restaurant to run the vehicle. And he went from $800 a month to zero. He was using no fuel to run his vehicle, so it was amazing. The group that helped him do some of this was a gentleman in Maypack, Wally Little, and another friend of his, Jonathan Burns, got together and created a company called Viotech. And Viotech is the company that actually invented the Geo, which is a type of device that you put into your diesel trucks and you convert the waste vegetable over into diesel fuel. It's not biodiesel like most people think. It's actually run on waste vegetable oil, and it's processed through a system that we have in some of our facilities now that Viotech helped us get together with the county.
But all you're doing is putting something in your tank that's going to convert this?
Yes, it's an invention that it's been around for years. The Europeans in Germany used to use it back in the 40s and 50s when they were running low on diesel fuel. They would use it, convert their waste vegetable oil over into a alternative fuel. And the process really is done with a straining of the waste vegetable oil, because some cars are designed just to run on straight vegetable oil, which has not been used. So they used to call this stuff used cooking oil instead of waste vegetable oil, just to stop the confusion. But when you filter this stuff down, it becomes a little purer. And we have some examples here. And this is what happens after just filtering it through it's not rocket science. It's just a 55-gallon drum that we have filters in. And you just, yeah, we have a picture of it. That actually just helps it settle. The biggest thing for waste vegetable oil is to heat it up and then let it settle so the particulate matter goes to the bottom, and then you just use the fresh parts of the stuff. And as you can see by the picture there, it's just something that Viotech designed on their own. They put two 55-gallon drums together with heating bands on them and filter tops on them. So you just filter the waste vegetable oil from the top, and then you transfer it over to the other one. You cook it a little bit to about 90 degrees, so it's easy to pump. And then you store it for a little longer period of time. And as you can see, it goes from a thick consistency with a lot of particulate matter into a almost pure, it's like virgin olive oil is what you end up getting. The facilities that we use at Glen Island Park is the Glen Island Harbor Club, which is a beautiful catering facility right on Glen Island. And they use almost anywhere from 90 to 200 gallons a week. So they were paying $150 a week to remove this from the waste stream, and actually putting it into the waste stream, excuse me. So now we're taking it out of the waste stream, not causing any trucks to come pick it up or deliver it and get rid of it for them. And we're saving them $600 a month. And then they're giving us a product that's so good because it's canola oil that we can transfer into a product that comes out pretty much clean. And we can also mix it with diesel fuel, because this is regular diesel fuel mixed with 5%, because that's what we're doing in our facilities now. We're instead of converting all our vehicles, because the vehicles cost anywhere from $3,000 to $5,000 to convert, which you could get back in the payback on that is very quick if you're using the vehicles a lot like we do around our facilities. So you can, the break-even point would probably be about 4 or 5 months on that. So, but some of the vehicles that we use are garbage trucks and diesel trucks that we use to haul garbage back and forth in the county. City Carting is now using our waste vegetable oil that we process to put into their trucks that haul from the transfer stations back and forth on the county. So we're putting 5% right into our, this is what would be 5% of waste vegetable oil and diesel fuel. So right off the bat, we put in 5%. And that you don't have to do a conversion to, which is nice.
And we also use 5% in all of our heating oil.
Mm-hmm. We've started this year with putting 5% of the waste vegetable oil straight into our underground tanks and using it to heat all our buildings
really?
And stuff.
Which cuts our costs.
Well, that's mm-hmm. a 5% immediate reduction.
Right. And yeah. You can see one of our vehicles that we use at Glen Island Park is our plow truck in the winter. And that runs, that was converted. That was cost about $4,000 to convert over with the Geo invention that Viotech designed. And they changed that truck, which is an older 99 truck, to run straight on vegetable oil. So that doesn't use diesel except for starting and stopping. It's what they call a two-tank conversion kit. You still have your diesel option if you want to use it with diesel in case you run out of the waste vegetable oil, or you can use it 100% waste vegetable oil. So that's what we have running one of our plow trucks. And then we also have another step van that they were going to auction it off in our fleet. And we decided to take that, and we use that mixing 5 to 10%, whatever, you know, the temperature is outside. Because that's what the waste vegetable oil, most people are concerned about, that in the colder months, this stuff is going to freeze up and mm-hmm. congeal and stuff. And that doesn't happen unless you go above a certain mixture rate. So we're doing 5%. We haven't had any kind of problem with that. And we can also, in the future, go up more if they decide that that's what they want to do. But it's been around for quite a while.
You're only using 5% of this?
5% mix. This is the mix. 5% mix waste vegetable oil to diesel fuel. With the conversion kits that we have, like on our vehicle, we can use 100%. We can run the trucks 100% on that. We wanted to include all the vehicles, so we started this 5% this past year, and we've had great success putting it into our fuel oil for our buildings and also into our fleet vehicles. And the county has about 1,200 vehicles, so we're saving substantial money on that. So and the big thing is we're lowering our carbon footprint because this stuff is carbon neutral, which means that you can actually do a handkerchief test on the back of the tailpipe, where you put a handkerchief over the tailpipe, and with a diesel, it'll come out black. You put that over while it's running on waste vegetable oil, and it comes out clean. So you're not getting any pollutants in the air compared to the diesel.
It's much lower mm-hmm. particulate matter. And the carbon neutral is about, it's a waste product. We've already produced the oil. Someone has already produced the oil. It's already been used once for the cooking need. And now, rather than put it into the waste stream, we're reusing it and we're getting it out of the waste stream. And it reduces our carbon footprint in that way.
Well, how does it differ from biofuel?
Well, there's biodiesel, which is waste vegetable oil. You can make biodiesel from either unused vegetable oil, some that's just fresh from being pressed, or you can make it from waste vegetable oil. And it goes through a chemical process, and it has to be, it has a couple extra steps to it that waste vegetable oil doesn't have. Waste vegetable oil, you're basically just filtering out the parts that would clog up your engine. It's sort of like running it through a really big sock. You know, just run it through this fabric material, warm it up, and then drain the water off. Let it settle and drain the water off. So it's a very simple process. You could make a kit to filter it yourself for, you know, $200. I mean, it's ridiculously inexpensive to do. And in that process, you can remove that material from the waste stream and all those pollutants from the air that you'd otherwise be getting from diesel emissions.
Uh-huh. What's nice about that is that we're not taking a agricultural product out of the agricultural sense and making it into a fuel. We're actually taking a waste product and making it into an alternative fuel. So the opponents of people saying, oh, now you're growing, you're taking the land that we used to use for our food stock and using it for our transportation needs, and now we're, you know, reducing the amount of land available. So this is not doing that. It's actually nice because we're taking out a waste product that would have been most likely thrown away, dumped into our landfills or used somewhere else, and we're using it as a transportation product that doesn't pollute, which is, you know, a really good.
We could go on forever, but I think I'm running out of time. This is so interesting. What we were looking at, because a lot of the farmers who use corn for feeding their livestock were finding that they had to pay much higher because our plants were using corn. But now, in order to get this cleaner fuel, but now what they're doing is they're talking about taking the shrub and the chips of trees and things that are, you know, they're at the end of the waste stream. They're not harming anyone, whereas raising the price of corn harms our farmers. So as we move ahead, I thank you so much. It's been so interesting. Thank you, Leah. The very, very interesting stuff. And thank you so much, Tino. This discussion, I think, should be continued with each of you in each of your homes, because there are many ways that each of us can do our share to reduce our carbon footprint, to do more recycling, to do more, you know, more with the sun, more not only solar, but also wind. And I think these are things that we have to look to the future for. Thank you for listening. This is State Senator Suzi Oppenheimer signing off with a report from the State Senate.